discuss my work with Andrey Reznikov about estimates of periods of automorphic functions and connected estimates of L functions. And I wanted to just to discuss the case which we did, but recently Reznikov discovered some general setup how to investigate these problems, and I would like to discuss this setup. Some side remarks that L functions have several faces. So one of them is, which is mostly investigated, is connection to automorphic forms. But there's another thing which is Riemann hypothesis, or it's maybe too high aimed. Let's consider Lindelöf hypothesis. So it is quantifiable, so you can approach it a little bit. So there is some convexity bounds for L functions, and interesting thing. I don't know. The device is on. So okay. Okay, I'll try to speak louder. So we propose some general method how using representation theory to give some subconvexity bound of different L functions. In fact, we are not working with L functions. We are giving estimates for periods, and periods are sometimes connected to L functions. Now, you'll see that in the setup which I describe, natural thing would be to consider Abelian groups. But I will discuss only real groups, and moreover, my real groups will be very small groups. So main example will be, let's consider PJ2R and some close relatives of this group. So it will be just And moreover, I will be interested only in mass forms, but we'll discuss this later. Okay, so now I would like to describe setup by Reznikov. So let's consider, suppose I have group and subgroup. So it's called Gitfun pair. If for any irreducible representation, pi e of g the space e star h is one dimensional. So trivial representation of h appears in e with multiplicity 1. So when h is compact, this is an ambiguous statement. When h is not compact, one should be a little bit more careful. Namely, and so we assume that e is smooth. And then the statement is that that I of e, which is home over h e into c, is one dimensional, is less or equal one dimensional. So this is notion of Gitfun pair, and we will use stronger notions, strong Gitfun pair. So then this means that if you have irreducible representation pi g e and irreducible representation rho h w, then the space I denote it rho pi, which is home over h w e into w, is no more than one dimensional. So there are many examples of Gilfand pairs. There are not so many examples of strong Gilfand pairs, but there are some. So let me give some examples. Examples, for instance, G is equal to G naught and H is a torus. Second, G is equal to G naught and H is unipotent group. So this, in fact, in this case, it is not precisely true because this space may be for trivial character of unipotent group, this space is two-dimensional, but two-dimensional is also okay, so it's almost. And third example, which is will be important for us, is G is equal to G naught cross G naught, and H is delta G naught, diagonal subgroup. So it's known theorem that in this case, this is a strong Gilfand pair. Okay, so now let's fix this presentation. Consider these representations pi e and rho w. So we have this space of representations that I would like to choose some representative, some generator of this thing. I will denote it L or pi model. So I will fix some model of this representation, model of this representation, for instance, like principal series. So that's the main example which we consider, just switch to principal series, and fix some element here in this one-dimensional space. So how canonically can we choose it? So it's clear that it's not easy to choose it absolutely canonically, but if these representations are unitary, this fixed unitary structure, then one can show that one can choose this vector up to constant of absolute value 1. For example, just let's consider the case when W is a representation of discrete series. So then it will appear here as a discrete summand. And then you have canonical up to scalar 1 identification. In general, you also can have such procedures. So we'll fix, think of this condition. Okay, so now we go to atomorphic picture. Suppose I have discrete subgroup gamma in G. I consider space X, which is gamma mod G. It is G space, and I consider representation L2 of X. Now, since I will be working with smooth things, and I will only be interested in smooth functions here, always. Okay, so now suppose O is an orbit of H in X, and I assume that it's I assume that for simplicity in order to assume X is compact. So in case of uniform lattices, non-uniform lattices, one has to assume that some of representations are cuspidal and so on, so otherwise there's not too much difference. So let's fix orbit, which is compact. And this orbit is gamma H mod H. So then we have the following thing. We have then atomorphic representation. So before we fix orbit, so what's atomorphic representation? For me, always will be pair. So I have representation pi e and initialization E into C infinity of X. In this case, it is gamma intersection. So just I'm saying that this is an orbit, and hence it has this form. So for me, automorphic representation always means pair. I have some representation, and it's embedding into C infinity of X, and I always assume that it's unitary. In other words, I consider E to be a unitary representation, and my embedding is supposed to be compatible with unitary structure on this space. Okay, probably I should. Now we have this problem. Okay, let's try. Okay, so yes, so and then I have natural diagram. I have E is mapped into C infinity of X. This is mapped by restriction to C infinity of O. And now, since everything is compact, I have, in fact, decomposition. C infinity of O is decomposed into direct sum of images of over O, sum W O. So hence I have, if I fix pi and O, so pi nu is automorphic representation, but I will usually suppress nu. Just pi will mean automorphic representation. Representation of G and rho mu rho automorphic representation, representation of H. So then I will have here projection dual to mu, projection of this into W. So hence, looking at automorphic picture, if I have automorphic realization of representation E of representation pi and automorphic representation of realization of representation rho, I construct a morphism here, so which I denote L automorphic rho pi. And since this morphism is H equivalent, it should be proportional to the standard morphism which we constructed before. So before we constructed some morphism which didn't know anything about automorphic structure. And this should be proportional L okay, and so now this A rho pi, these are interesting objects. These are some kind of automorphic objects. Objects of automorphic nature. And using these things, we can describe everything. So the claim is that these things, in many cases, it's proven that these things are connected with automorphic L functions, expressed in terms of automorphic L functions. For example, so if you take case G is G naught, H is the torus. So then you have pi is automorphic representation. Representation of G naught. Rho is automorphic representation. Just character. Representation of H. So then one can show that this A rho pi squared is equal to some constant which depends just on. So in a Adelic language, this constant will disappear, and here you'll have some L function of some pi, that's 0.1 half, to divide by L function for joint case point or joint representations, dual group, and here's pi tensor. And here, so it's point one of pi at point one, something like this. I'm not interested in precise things. So now, so here the only thing that pi is, so h is torus, which corresponds to quadratic extension of our field of Q in this case, for instance, and then pi is representation of GL2 over this quadratic field, which corresponds to, which is a lifting of, represent quadratic lifting of pi. So something like this. So important thing is, so, just I don't want to know that this is connected to functions. Important thing here is that here you have a squared for trivial reason, because a itself is not defined. It's defined only up to element of absolute value one, because our original normalization was defined only up to this thing. So, and this is just for a moment. Okay, so. So, and now using this, so the idea is now what we are going to do, we are going to estimate these coefficients. So this is the problem which we consider. So these things will be connected to L functions. So in some cases it's proven, in some cases it may be conjectured. For non-arithmetic lattices it's not connected to L functions. But so we are going to prove something about this. So these coefficients we call periods. So, and we are going to prove something about these periods. And let me give, so let's see, first. First kind of bound. So first mean value bound. So let's fix representation pi, automorphic representation. And let's now vary row. Now representation row has some parameters. So it's a representation of some reductive groups. So for instance, G and H are reductive groups. So it has some parameter which, so it will denote, I will call the absolute value of this parameter analytic conductor. So C of rho. And so then the claim is that we have the following kind of estimate, that sum of these coefficients, A rho pi over all rho, with an analytic conductor less or equal to t, will be of t times t to the k, will be bounded. And this is, in fact, tight bound. So it means that you can put here some another constant times. So this is capital C and this is small t times t to the k, where k is some number which is explicitly computed. So the claim is that you can always prove this kind of bound. And I will indicate just indicate the proof. We will not go into details. So the idea is the following. They have my realization. And now what I can do, I can take element here. This is a function on x, and I can restrict it to u and consider L2 norm. So let's denote H O is Hermitian form on E, which is H O of U is equal integral U of whatever over O squared. And then it's easy to see that this thing will be this positive definite form. And then it's easy to see that this form is equal to sum a rho pi squared of all atomorphic rho is in atomorphic spectrum of O. So I consider sum of all representations. I decompose my representation of H on orbit O. It's compact orbit, so it decomposes into direct sum of representations. So I consider this decomposition times some H times some forms H rho, where form H rho is obtained in the following way. I have my H rho model, where H rho model is obtained in the following way. I have my model morphism A into W, and here I have L2 norm, unitary norm on W, so I can move it to E. So this is H rho model, and it's obvious that you have this kind of decomposition. So that's on one hand. So on the other hand, I claim that we have the following inequality. So basic inequality. That if you, so we have, so this is an emission form on E. On E, I have action of G. So hence G acts also on Hermitian forms there. So I can move my form by elements of G, and I can average this over some neighborhood of U. So let's consider averaging the spectrum. I fix some compact neighborhood in U, compact, open. No, not open, but compact neighborhood of one. And I consider averaging of pi of g h o. Then the claim is that this will be bounded by some explicit bound times standard Hermitian form on space E. E is a Hilbert space, so it has a standard Hermitian form. And this is obvious observation, just the idea that if you have delta function on O and you move it a little bit and smooth, you'll get something which is bounded by Lebesgue measure on X. Okay, so now from these two things, so you have, so here you have this thing. So now you if you substitute it on some vector, so you'll get on one hand, so this gives you estimate on R. So let's, so then I can write that sum a rho pi squared average of H rho model will be less or equal constant times P. Okay, so now I substitute here some vector, for instance, and see that this I can find the vector such that this will be of order more or less one for when conductor of rho is less or equal to some fixed number, and then it somehow decreases, and then I compute right-hand side of this norm. So this is the proof, so I, this is not in the center of my talk, so I don't want to elaborate on this more. Okay, so now, but the general thing here is that we have some mean value, that this is very general thing, that in this situation we always have some mean value bound. And this mean value bound, in some cases, when you interpret this in terms of L function, gives you convexity bounds for L functions. For L functions, there are some convexity bounds which follow from functional equation. Okay, so are there more? Wait, it's not. Material. Okay, so now let me describe next thing, maybe. Interesting thing is Gifan triple. Maybe suppose I have triple of groups, and suppose I fix a representation pi here and representation sigma here. In fact, in all examples, sigma will be trivial representation. So you can just think about this. Pi is fixed here. And here I, let's consider some intermediate representation. So W. So suppose I fixed this model functional L. Rho pi, and then L sigma rho. So then gives me L sigma pi from E to C. Okay. So suppose this is trivial representation, then this is just morphism to C model. Okay, so and now I can look at automorphic picture. So I have, consider X, I have orbit OH and orbit OD there. So then I have E subspace and C infinity of X. I can consider restriction, restriction to C infinity of OD. And then integrate. So I consider period with respect to D. So I get L automorphic from E to C to D invariant, D equivalent. Now I assume that this is strong Gelfand pair. This is, for instance, just simple Gelfand pair, doesn't matter. But this, of course, is not Gelfand pair. So this space will be the space of such function also, let's know that E, I, E, home over D, E, C, this will be some infinite dimensional space. And we constructed some vector in this space. And then the claim is that we have, in this case, we have decomposition. So this, so let's denote this somehow. L pi, it's just pi and sigma, but since pi and sigma will be fixed, so I will suppress it. So you'll get automorphic. I got some vector in this space of functionals, i.e. And then the claim is that using this decomposition, it's easy to see that we get the following decomposition of this vector. This L automorphic is equal to sum over all rho in automorphic spectrum of H. Here I will have some constants A rho times model functionals. So let me explain what are these constants. It's just proportionality constants. So I have E into W into C. So I have model functionals. L model. And also I have automorphic. L So I know that this is proportional to this with coefficient, which was, which we described as coefficient a, a rho pi. And here will be proportional with coefficient a sigma rho. So this, by definition, this is a rho. Now this functional, functionals are defined in the model. They don't know anything about automorphic picture. And so we have, we see that this automorphic functional can be decomposed as sum of some functionals which are a priori defined, times these expressions which have some kind of automorphic nature. Okay, and now this becomes interesting. If you consider pair of defined triples. So suppose I have, so this is the following setup. Suppose I have two defined triples with the same G and the same D. So I have two intermediate subgroups. Then I have this functional L automorphic, which is defined purely in terms of G and D. It doesn't know anything about H and H prime. But it has two completely different expansions. I can write it as sum over rho prime in automorphic spectra of H prime. These coefficients, let's not them be rho prime. Okay, so just distinguish from A times L rho prime model. And here you have sum over rho in automorphic spectra of H, A rho times this L rho model. Now, so here, so we have, so as a result, we got the following things that we have. Element in U of I, which is, so element is some functional on E, which has two expansions, which have completely different nature, even sum over completely unrelated sets. With coefficients, which are of automorphic nature. So this is some kind of analog of Rankine-Seidberg formula. So Rankine-Seidberg formula is a special case of this thing. Okay, so now, so we have, but, yes. Yes. So, yes, so, no, no, so unfolding, so here, the, so the main idea is that here we don't use, and it doesn't use subfolding. So, the proof of this just uses multiplicity one. So these are defined pairs and so on. So, the, as I understand, the case of, so it will be the following case. It should take G naught cross G naught. Here I have subgroup N cross N. Here is a subgroup delta G naught. And here I have subgroup N. So if you do it in this setup, you'll get. So N, as I explained, N is not completely a quotient subgroup, but you can do it. So if you just do it, you'll get one of the versions of Rankine-Seidberg formula. So the whole idea is that Rankine-Seidberg, standard proof of Rankine-Seidberg goes through unfolding. And unfolding is very powerful, but very of very limited applications. It works when it works. And this works, and this gives the same kind of results, but works in much more general setup. Okay, so now I will describe just the situation in which we can use this. So, in order to prove some inequalities, in order to prove some estimates. So, it's well known that if you have an identity, in order to get some estimates from this identity, you have to input some positivity. So that's, if you want to, see, I want to use this identity to get, so what does it mean identity? So I have identity of two functionals, so I can substitute some vectors and get, for every vector, I get identity between these numbers. So let's maybe I'll write some A rho, L rho of U is equal some B rho prime, L rho prime of U. So this is something which I know very explicitly for any vector U, and I get this equality. And so I get a lot of identities. And now I want to use this identity in order to get some estimates, for instance, on these numbers. So in order to do this, usually you should, you can get this kind of estimates if you know some positivity. So how to get positivity? Okay, so let's. So you get positivity, you just put V transit V prime into the picture, and this is how you get positivity. So let me, so suppose I have a general, suppose I have, now I should use some other groups, so I should introduce some notations for them. So let's, let I have strong Gelfand pair, RP. Okay, so, and then I can consider the group G, which is the following tower, R cross R, P cross P, delta R, delta P. So, and now I would like, so I fix a presentation of, so some representation pi V representation of R. R, and I would like to decompose, to consider these coefficients, some representation rho P. P, I don't know in what space. So the idea is that, yes, so then, so if I have such a presentation, I will consider a presentation V tensor V bar is a representation of G. And then when I restrict it here, then coefficients here will be squares of corresponding coefficient here, so so A pi tensor pi bar pi tensor is equal A rho pi times A rho bar, so is equal A rho pi squared. So in other words, all coefficients here will be positive. And if I consider here vector which is positive, so for instance, vector V tensor V bar, so then in this expression, I will get that all these coefficients are positive and all these coefficients will be positive. So I want to... because I want positivity. So where will I get positivity? So I have this. Yes, but since here I will have trivial representation, then automatically it will be lower bar. Yes, you're right. Okay, so in this case, we will get that these coefficients are positive, and we find sufficiently many vectors u for which this weight function is positive. And on the other hand, on the left-hand side, sometimes we can estimate. So I will explain in a moment. So how we can estimate this using mean value bound. So let me explain. So the idea is, so suppose we found vector u in either equal v tensor v bar such that, first of all, the function L which is this L L prime of U is a is positive and is a bell-like function. So it's something like this. It has jumped somewhere. That's first condition. And the second condition is suppose that function on the left hand side, L rho of u, is smooth function, so it doesn't have jumps. Jumps. So it's on large intervals, it's approximately constant. So then what will happen is that then I claim that we can estimate left-hand side because we know sums of these coefficients over large intervals. So if you have function which is more or less constant, then it gives you estimates of left-hand side. So this gives you estimate of the right-hand side. And hence, it gives, because of bell-like nature of this function, gives estimate for sum of these coefficients over this small interval. Okay, so now I can, so it seems that I'm in good shape. So, now let me just explain the case in which we carried out this procedure, in which was in some sense starting point. So so we can see the case. So G is equal G naught cross G naught. So let's R is equal G naught cross G naught. So it means that G is equal G naught cross G naught cross G naught cross G naught. P is equal delta G naught. So it means that P, the corresponding group H will be delta G naught cross delta G naught. So this gives us one, so this is H, and D is just delta of G. So this is G1, G2, G3, G4. This is G prime. And this is G, which is diagonal. So this is one Gitfand triple. And now we can consider another Gitfand triple where we just switch 2 and 3. So another Gitfand triple, H prime, will be G prime. And then, if you do computations, you get, you in this situation, you find this function of this type, and this allows us to prove subconvexity bound on these coefficients, so which are triple product coefficients, so A so A rho P pi rho. So it means that if you have okay, so if you have a representation of the group G naught cross G naught, so it is some V tensor V prime. So let's consider V tensor V bar and have another representation, so W representation of G naught. Then you construct this coefficient which correspond to so AW V V bar, and this gives estimates of some subconvexity, estimate of these coefficients. So it's known that these coefficients in some cases correspond to triple L function, and so this gives some estimate on triple L function. So that's thing which we did, and the problem with this approach was that it gave strong bound for triple L function, which subconvexity bound for triple L function, which is not available by other methods. But unfortunately, it was stuck. So we had this bound, we couldn't do anything in for other cases. So, and I think that using this setup, which I described, now we have some flexibility, you know, what to do. So we haven't done many things, but it's clear how, where to go. And I would like to make one more remark, which is not precisely connected with this, but with somehow nature of L functions. So good. So, okay. So before this, maybe I will just finish with this thing. So as a result, we prove this bounds on periods. So we get, as a result, we have sum of a small, estimates of sum of small of this A rho pi, the conductor of rho is minus t is less than t to the 1/3. So, yes. So we get estimates for some reasonable estimates of this sum, which are worse than Lindelöf conjecture, but better than so pointwise estimates which you get from this will be good. And we get this from so the computation which we have to do are just computations in the model. All things we should do is just computations model. This computation is done using stationary phase method, because all expressions which we meet are given by some integrals of exponential functions, so you just estimate them. Okay, and I want just to make one more remark, which is somehow I find a little mysterious. Namely, this connected with this notion of Gelfand triple. So I have this E, W, let's be L, which is usually equal to C, but it doesn't matter. So here I have product model functions. They consider the product, so L o pai, é o sigma, é o sigma, é o pai. Now the ID is it, so I can see the L row, which is just product times L. Okay. So the idea is that one can see immediately that this function is doesn't depend on the choice of model of W, that it depends only on these things. So as a result, if I consider this corresponding coefficient, so I write L rho automorphic is equal to some A rho, so I will suppress pi and sigma times L rho model, then this coefficient depends only on so its indeterminacy depends only on pi and sigma. So if I fix pi and sigma, then this coefficient is well defined. So from my point of view, it means that it's something like, should be something like L function, some expression of L function. So more precisely, since it does depend on normalization of E and L, so for instance, if you take a ratio of two such things for rho and rho prime, then it is well defined. So this expression, now if you try to compute it, then you'll see that it's somehow, so we know that A rho squared is an L function, some expression, some L function, it has a real product. If you try to compute it, then it turns out that this A rho will be some half of this error product. So this means that if I take this expression, this will have error product, but some error product of not Langlands type. Somehow it will get just half of one L function, half of another L function. And it seems that it makes sense. So that it should be some L function which is not Langlands L function. So okay, so that's so I don't know what. So okay, so it's not defined, it depends on normalization, but for instance, ratio of two such things seems to be well defined. So it seems that there are some generalizations of L functions which appear in this approach. Yes, yes, yes. This special, no, no. So here is, of course, the problem. Usually, a function you define it by convergence things extend. This makes sense only at the point where probably the product doesn't converge. But nevertheless, it seems to be. So the square. So the idea is that square module of this is a function. That's not a problem. But it seems that this thing in itself makes sense. That you have, so to say, canonical, so to say. If you have this L function, it's positive, and you have canonical, so to say, not square root, but some element which absolute value of square of which is this value of L function. Okay, so this is just additional remark. Okay, so I think that. Yes.
This formula, which is yours main point, is quite interesting because usually you take a sum and you dualize it by a trace formula or Poisson sum formula, but your thing is on both sides, spectrum. There's no geometric side, so to speak. So, but you're saying by dualizing from one to another, you get a subconvex estimate, which to me is strange. But you have
okay.
Succeeded, I know, in one.
Yes. No, so maybe I want to emphasize that here the difference between different type of trace formula here is that we fix one representation of G. So we spectral expansion goes inside this representation. You have different, when you stick to H, you have spectral expansion, but the presentation of G is fixed. So it is slightly different from usual type of trace form where you have to deal simultaneously with all the presentations. Somehow, at least here, we fix this representation. This is advantage and disadvantage, but nevertheless, and just very low. Okay.